In this chapter, we are going to discuss the conduction and breakdown phenomenon in solid dielectric materials. So we know that solid dielectric materials are used in different kind of electrical apparatuses to isolate from one current carrying part to another current carrying part. These are operating at different voltage levels. So the good dielectric should have a low dielectric loss, high mechanical strength. It should be free from gaseous inclusions. Means should not be any the gas particles or liquid particles having the lowest dielectric strength, and it should be free from the moisture content, and resistance to thermal and the chemical deterioration must be high. So we know that the solid dielectrics have higher breakdown strength compared to that the liquid and the gases. Say let us for gases it is 30 kV and the liquid for it is 100 kV for the practical applications. In the case of solid, we are expecting more than that. There are the two different type of the materials which we are using for the composition of solid dielectric particles, solid dielectric materials. One is organic materials. These are paper, wood, and rubber. Another one is inorganic materials such as mica, glass, and the porcelain, synthetic polymers, then PVC, epoxy resistance, etc. So we know that when the breakdown occurs, solid get permanently damaged while the gas is fully, and the liquid partly recovers their dielectric strength after the applied dielectric fluid is removed. So it is very important thing to know it in the case of solid materials. So we should understand the phenomenon, because if there is a breakdown, completely collapse, that's nothing but the spalling of the materials will takes place. So the different theories, the various breakdown phenomenon explains and classification as below. It is mainly depending upon the time of the application of the voltage. So let's go one by one. That is, first one is intrinsic or ionization or ionic breakdown. So this is only because of the ionization phenomenon there is a breakdown that takes place. That we understood in the case of the gaseous phenomenon, and also we understood how actually there is an ionization phenomenon that takes place. One electron which is liberated and collide with an atom, so epsilon is greater than the Vi value, that is nothing but ionization potential. There is a liberation of the additional electrons and the one capacitor atom. This is nothing but ionization, we can call it as. This is the responsible for the breakdown. This is the initial one. Next we have electromechanical breakdown phenomenon. So this is nothing but we know that the insulators are subjected to that the hanging in nature, and resulting in there is an mechanical blending will take into action. So because of this there is a breakdown that takes place, and not only based on this mechanical structure, it is also subjected to that there is a rise in the temperature because it is operating for over a period of time. Then next one is failure due to treeing and cracking. So when the solid insulators are subjected to that continuous operating for over a period of time, so this will be in the nature of outermost layers will be dried in nature, so resulting in there is a formation of the treeing, and the current pulses are moving from one end to the another end of the insulator, so resulting in there is a cracking. So more about this we are going to discuss later on. Then we have thermal breakdown. When the insulator subjected to the over a period of time, there is a rise in the temperature of the outermost layers of the insulator, so resulting in there is some phenomenal takes place. This is explained by thermal breakdown. Then we have electrochemical. Because of the rise in the temperature, there is an electrochemical deterioration taken to picture. So this is explained by electrochemical breakdown phenomenon. And we have a breakdown due to internal discharges. So suppose if there is a presence of any void say like gaseous inclusions or liquid inclusions, resulting in there is an the permittivity of that inclusions, and the insulator will be varies. So there is a possibility of the internal discharges may take places. So resulting in there is a breakdown. So this is the figure which is trying to explain. This is nothing but variation of the breakdown strength with the time after application of the voltages. So this x-axis is nothing but the log time, and y-axis is the breakdown strength. So initially there is a breakdown strength will be very high. It is initiated by ionization. That is nothing but we know some of the electrons which are liberated from cathode element will directed to the anode. So there is nothing but ionization. That is nothing but internship. Then it is followed by electromechanical bending. So resulting in, we know that. So earlier, because of the rise in the temperature, there is a diameter. Remember this. There is a the size will be remains the same. Diameter of the insulator will increases. So it is subject to that. It is in the nature of elasticity. A rise in the diameter. Then after subjected to some time, elasticity will fail and plasticity will come into the picture. That is nothing but diameter of insulator will get reduces. So this is the, it will go undergo such a fluctuation from elasticity to a plasticity. And how does this will affect? So this is subject to that electromechanical structure. Then it is followed by the streamers, so same as the Townsend, first followed by Townsend first and second, then followed by the streamers in the case of the gases. Same thing happens in the case of the solid insulators. Then the thermal is subjected to the longer period of time, continuously operating, there is a rise in the temperature. So whatever the energy which is gained by the insulator, it should be, there must be thermal equilibrium. Otherwise, there is a rise in the temperature of the insulator that takes place. This is subject to the thermal. Then last one is erosion and the electrochemical. So resulting all this, so there is a complete decomposition of that chemical decomposition takes place across the insulator. So resulting in there is a conduction and the breakdown takes place. So you can understand earlier it is initially it is the breakdown strength is high, goes on reducing, and resulting in this there is a breakdown takes place. Coming to the first one, internship breakdown. So when the voltages is applied for the short duration of the order of 10 to the power of minus 8 second, the dielectric strength of the solid materials increases in rapidly up to an upper limit. It is called intrinsic electric strength. So this is the highest value which we can get with very less time duration. So the maximum electrical strength which is recorded is 15 megawatt per centimeter for polyvinyl alcohol at 186 degrees Celsius. So maximum strength usually obtainable ranges from 5 megavolt to 10 megavolt centimeters. This is the experimental condition which we can get to the maximum breakdown strength of the solid materials. So this is intrinsic breakdown mainly depends on the presence of the free electrons, which are capable of migration through the lattice of the dielectrics. So these three are the responsible for the conduction phenomenon in the case of the intrinsic breakdown. So usually there is some number of conduction electrons will be present in the solid dielectrics, along with some structural imperfections, or sometimes both will act as a trap for the conduction of the electrons up to a certain range of electric field and the temperatures. So when these are exceeded, additional electrons will be liberated, and these electrons participate in the conduction process. So this is how we understood the case of ionization phenomenon. Based on this, there are the two principles which is going to explain. First one is electronic breakdown, and another one is avalanche or streamers breakdown. So this is the same as how actually there is a conduction is process, conduction is takes place in the case of the gases gaseous phenomena. So let's go for first one, electronic breakdown. We know that as mentioned earlier, initial, let's say, intrinsic breakdown will be very high at the time duration 10 to the power of 8 minus 8 second. So initial density of the conductions or the free electrons, we are assuming to be very large, because something how actually we consider by applying there is a high voltage across both the cathode and the anode side, or UV light is falling on the element in the case of the gas. Like we are assuming that there is a number of the electrons which are present at the initials are large, and electron-electron collisions occur, so resulting in this phenomenon. So when the electric field is applied, because of this, there is an electrons will gain the energy by the electric field, and cross of the forbidden energy gap from the valency to the conduction band. So this is a repeated process. So resulting in there is a more number of the electrons which are liberated. Eventually there is an there will lead to that there is a breakdown phenomenon. Just we are assuming that for the period of 10 to the power of minus 8 second. So at the initial, we should make sure that there is a large or huge number of the electrons to be participate in the process, and resulting in there is a breakdown phenomenon takes place. And coming to the second one, we have avalanche or streamers breakdown phenomenon. Avalanche or streamers breakdown. So this is nothing but it is similar to the breakdown in the gas of breakdown in the gas due to the cumulative ionizations. So there will be a breakdown occurs when the electron avalanche bridges the gap between the two electrodes. So an electron within the dielectrics, it will start from cathode, will drift towards the anode, and during this motion gains the energy because of the electric field, and it will lose the energy because of the collisions. So we know that when the energy gained by the electron exceeds the ionization potential, lattice ionization potential, there is a liberation of the additional electrons, and because of this collision process, that is nothing but how we understood for the first ionization coefficient. This process will repeat, so resulting in there is a formation of the electron avalanche. So there is a possibility of the breakdown will occur when the avalanche exceeds a certain critical sizes. So in practice, breakdown is not occurs by the formation of the single avalanche itself, but occurs as a result of the many avalanches within the dielectric and extending step by step through the entire thickness of the material. So this is nothing but we can explain the same as the conduction because of the Townsend first ionization coefficients. So there is a liberation of the electrons, free electrons will move from one electron to another electron. So there is a collision. So because of the electric field, it will gain the energy, and because of the collisions, and it will lose the some part of the energy. So when this is happens continuously, there is a too many number of the electrons will liberating. So resulting in there is an avalanche will takes place between the two electrodes. So if it is could not able to withstand that, there is an initiation of the streamers will takes place between the two electrodes. So we should assume that there is no single streamers will participate in that. There is a too many number of the streamers. So when the streamers could be able to initiate between the two electrodes, there is a possibility of the conduction. Resulting in the conduction, there is a breakdown will take place. With the help of the some experimental conditions, so we are trying to explain that this is the point to plane. Let us assume that point is connected to the source and plane is connected to the ground side. So this is nothing but there is one electron which is liberated, and because of the electric field between these two, it will gain the energy and start drifting from one electron to another electron. So you can see that it having the too many number of the branches. So this is nothing but it is not followed by the single one. This one, which one having the crosses from one electrode to another electrode, we can call it as it is a leader. It is a leader is followed by the too many number of the followers. So leader is responsible for the conduction between the two electrodes. Once the conduction is takes place, there is a possibility of the breakdown may take place. Let's see, assume that this is one of the streamers which is drifting from one electrode to another electrode, and it have the 2 min number of the followers. So because of this ionization, it will gain the energy and start for drift from one electrode to another electrode. So like this, it having the 2 min number of the branches. So where the streamers could able to cross the lattice ionization potential, there is a conduction. This is nothing but we can see it is a conduction. This is the responsible for the conduction between this electrode and the one electrode to the another electrode, let us from past to the plane. So these are also things will help in the process of the ionization, but could not able to cross the forbidden energy. So this is nothing but we can say it is a streamers. Once the streamers are initiated, means it there is a breakdown takes place between the two electrodes. This is also same will happens in the case of the solid, but having the 2 million number of the complex phenomenon in the case of the solid. This is just considering that between point to the plane. Then we have next concept, that is electromechanical breakdown. When the insulators are subjected to the high electric fields, there is a possibility of the failures because of the electrostatic compressive forces, which will exceed the mechanical compressive strengths. Let us consider that if the thickness of the specimen is a D0 value and the compressed thickness is considered as a D under the applied voltage of V. When the electrically developed compressive stress in the equilibrium condition, then the equation will become epsilon var V square by 2 D square. You see that is equal to Y into ln of D0 by D value. So Y is nothing but Young's modulus. So rearranging this equation, we will get V square is equal to D square in a bracket 2Y by epsilon value ln of D0 by D value. So usually there is a mechanical instability will occurs at D by D0. D is nothing but compressed, and this is D0 value is the specimen. That is equal to 0.6, or D0 by D value will become 1.67. So we should understand that before the compression, what is the diameter of the insulator, and after subjected to that, there is a compression, there is a change in the diameter. So this is the ratio we have to consider, 0.6 and the 1.67. Substituting these values in the above equation, so we will get highest apparent electric stress before the breakdown. We could be able to get that is nothing but E maximum is equal to V by D. Okay, V by D naught, that is equal to substituting these values, 0.6, it is in the bracket Y by epsilon naught value to the power of half. So this is the equation is only approximately based on the Young's modulus, and it is depending upon the mechanical stress. When the material is subjected to that high stress, theory of the elasticity does not hold good, then we have to consider the theory of the plasticity has to be considered. Then recently this theory has been modified on the concept of fracture mechanism. New mechanism is considered that the filamentary shaped cracks will propagate through the dielectric materials, resulting in there is a both electrostatic and the electromechanical strain energy stored in the material because of the applied electric field. So this is same as the conventional mechanical crack propagation in the brittle materials. These cracks propagate spontaneously if the strain energy raised is greater than that required to overcome the toughness of the material. So these are the filamentary cracks type of the filamentary cracks are the responsible for the conduction and the breakdown phenomenon in the case of the electromechanical breakdown. Next we have thermal breakdown. Breaking voltage of the solid dielectric should increase with its thickness, but it is true only up to a certain thickness. After that, heat generated in the dielectric due to the flow of the current determines the conduction. When the electric field is applied to a dielectric, conduction current, however it is very small, will flow through the material. This will heat up the specimen and the temperature of the specimen rises. The heat generated will transfer to the surrounding medium by conduction through the solid dielectrics, and there is a radiation out from the outer surface. There will be an equilibrium reached when the heat generated, that is when heat used to raise the temperature of the dielectric plus the heat radiated out is equal to the heat generated. Means heat generated, if it is equal to, there is a rise in temperature and some part of the energy is radiated out. The heat generated under DC stress, E is given as WDC is equal to, this is for DC, is for the DC supply, E square sigma, it is watt per centimeter cube. So where sigma is nothing but DC conductivity of the specimen. So whereas in the case of the field, the heat generated is WAC is equal to E square F epsilon square tan delta by 1.8 into the power of 12 watt per centimeter cube. And the frequency is nothing, F is equal to frequency, it is in hertz. Delta is nothing but the loss angle of the specimen, and E is nothing but it is in RMS value. So heat dissipated, which is given as WT is equal to CV DT capital T by small t, it is a derivative of K gradient T. T is nothing but it is the temperature of the specimen with respect to small t is nothing but the time, where CV is equal to specific heat of the specimen and capital T is nothing but temperature of the specimen and K is nothing but thermal conductivity of the specimen. Small t is the time over which it is, the heat is dissipated. So when the equilibrium is reached, the heat generated in the case of AC and the DC is equal to that heat dissipated. In the practice, there is always some heat, it is radiated out. So let's consider that there is a figure, it will explain that thermal instability in the solid, excess is nothing but the temperature and y axis is nothing but heat generated or heat lost. So here we have the two conditions, that is E1 and E2, and there is a straight line which you can see, it is nothing but the heat lost. So heat lost, which is in the straight line, while the heat generated, we have the E1 and E2 shown in separated curves. At the field E2, the breakdown occurs at the both the temperature, it is a TA and the TB. In the temperature range, if that C between TA and the TB, heat generated, which you can see that heat generated is less than the heat lost. It is generated is less than the heat lost for the field E2. And hence, breakdown will not occur at these regions. So this is of the great importance for the practicing the engineer for the insulating in high voltage apparatus due to the thermal breakdown. There is a thermal breakdown sets up an upper limit for increase in the breakdown voltage when the thickness of the insulation is increasing. For a given loss angle, the applied stress, the heat generated, which is directly proportional to the frequency, which you can see that in the case of the AC, WAC is directly proportional to the frequency. Hence, the thermal breakdown is more severe in the case of the high frequencies. This will give us that the breakdown, thermal breakdown voltages at various materials under AC and the DC applications. So that is conclusion, we can make the conclusion that, so AC it is subject to the frequency. So if there is a rise in the frequency, there is a change in frequency, increase in the frequency, there is the heat generated will be, it is of the increasing the high value. So it is of the great importance to choose that in the size of the insulator subject to the thermal breakdown.